Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cybercrime Investigator's Handbook by Graeme Edwards, narrated by Curt Bonnem. Foreword. Cybercrime investigation is a discipline relevant to an increasingly diverse audience. It's a profession that has evolved with technology, and that is constantly being presented with challenges in determining the truth behind alleged events. As part of the broader cybersecurity profession, investigators in large part are valued for their practical experience, vendor certifications, and trustworthiness in delivering investigative outcomes, whether that be to prove or disprove alleged offending. Graeme Edwards embodies these qualities. He forged a career as one of Australia's first true cybercrime detectives with the Queensland Police Service. Like many in our profession, he took it upon himself to continue to self-develop through learning about and adapting to new technology environments and through advancing his own education. His doctorate furthered his expertise in cloud investigations and forensics, anticipating the growing need for this subspecialization. Cybercrime Investigator's Handbook is a life work for Graeme. It provides an opportunity for listeners to directly benefit from his unique expertise and lifelong learning experiences. Its content steps listeners through the investigative process from a cybercrime perspective, capturing key practical and observational gems listeners can readily apply to their own challenges. Thanks to authors like Graeme, our profession can continue to evolve and benefit from the passing on of key lessons and knowledge for the betterment of practitioners and those looking to move into the exciting field of cybercrime investigations. It's a very timely contribution. I trust you'll benefit from its content as much as I have. Thank you, Graeme, for advancing our profession in this very meaningful way. Professor David Lacey, Managing Director, IDCare. Director, Institute for Cyber Investigations and Forensics, USC. Chapter 1. Introduction. Cyber attacks against businesses and individuals have been occurring for decades. Many have been so successful they were never discovered by the victims, and only identified while the data was being exploited or being sold on criminal markets. Cyber attacks damage the finances and reputation of a business and cause significant damage to those whose data has been stolen and exploited. From the criminal's perspective, the current cyber environment effectively gives them a free pass when it comes to attacking their target. They can do whatever they like to an individual or business online, cause immense damage of a professional or personal nature, and make large sums of money safe in the knowledge the complainant will rarely report the matter to police. In fact, this is a strange anomaly about cybercrime. A company has millions of dollars of intellectual property, or IP, stolen from them, has all the personally identifying information, or PII, of the staff and clients stolen, and the action of reporting it to police or investigating who is behind the attack is rarely considered or undertaken unless forced by local legislation. Consequently, from the criminal's perspective, there is little to no downside to being a cybercriminal. They operate on a high financial return, low-risk model. Due to the high volume and complexity of cyber attacks, should a victim decide to refer a complaint to police, they cannot always rely on them to be available to undertake an investigation and locate the offender. Police resources are stretched, and skilled cyber investigators in law enforcement are few and overworked. This means organizations subject to a cyber attack that wish to find information about who is behind the attack will need to hire an experienced cyber investigator, scarce and very expensive, or investigate the matter themselves. Alternatively, they will not conduct an investigation and instead focus on increasing security. The decision by victims to not investigate a cybercrime is made for many reasons, including the time and money to be expended on an investigation, the focus of the business being directed on the investigation, the internal disruption it causes, and the reputational harm caused when the community finds the company's security has been breached and all the data entrusted to them stolen. Also, directors would not look forward to the day that they stand before a public annual general meeting and explain to the shareholders that all the company data was stolen on their watch and that they have made no effort to recover it or identify who took it. To the members of an incident response, or IR team, or the cyber investigator, responding to an attack is often an inexact science, as the attacker's motives and skill levels vary. Whereas an attack against a single desktop computer may be easily contained and investigated, an attack against a complete distributed corporate network will require significant resources and an experienced response team to protect the company, their data, and clients. As the attack methodologies vary, the investigation strategy will not necessarily follow the exact same path each time. Investigating a cyber attack may be a critical part of the continuation of the business. When the attack is discovered, a mixture of panic, stress, anxiety, and fear is seen among staff, and those tasked to mitigate and eradicate the attack may feel the future of the company rests upon their shoulders. Many employees will be concerned as to their personal future, as they will be familiar with the many stories of businesses hit by a cyber attack that no longer exist 6 months later. Staff members of the organization being interviewed as a part of the incident response may also feel that they are being held responsible, and that the interview is a method of laying blame at their feet. So why conduct an investigation and gather evidence? Why should a company start investigating the cybercrime and try to track down the offender? With the proliferation in the instances of cybercrime, there is an expectation among the community that those who are entrusted with their PII take their responsibilities seriously and ensure their data is secure. Shareholders of companies who find that the value of their shares and/or dividends is affected by a breach may demand efforts by the company to identify and prosecute the attacker. In the initial aftermath of the attack, there may be the possibility of locating the suspect and the digital property taken and recovering it before it is exploited. It may be argued that the duties and responsibilities of a director include trying to recover the stolen corporate data before it is exploited. Outside of law enforcement and several large businesses, such as the major accounting companies, there are few options for those who want to have an investigation into a cyber attack conducted. The IR team may find evidence pointing to a suspect, but it is generally not their job to prepare a case for referral to police or lawyers. A cyber investigator is a very specialized position and is roughly the equivalent of a police detective conducting a criminal investigation, as the rules of evidence the court demands are the same whether you are an experienced detective or a civilian investigator. The cyber investigator is viewed as the person who is tasked with finding evidence of the person behind the attack, and in some cases, preparing a referral to police or commencing a civil prosecution. While many attacks originate from overseas and are hidden behind multiple legal jurisdictions, anonymizers, bots, or other technology, people have their own motivations to commit crimes. And these people may include current or former employees residing within your local jurisdiction. The role of the cyber investigator is an extension of the digital investigator. For the benefit of this book, the digital investigator is the person who conducts a forensic examination of a device or network and produces a report on the evidence seized and identified. This book is intended for the person assigned the task of investigating the cyber event, with a view to gaining a full understanding of the event and, where possible, recovering the IP and/or PII before it is exploited. They may also be tasked with finding evidence to support an action in a tribunal, for example, employment court, or a potential prosecution in a civil or criminal court should the attacker be identified. It will also be of benefit to the manager, executive, and/or lawyer who is tasked to review an investigation to understand the actions of the investigation team and why certain decisions were made and to gain an understanding of the evidence available from a cybercrime scene and the follow-up investigation. This is not a book that describes how to technically respond to and mitigate a cyber attack, as there are many books covering this topic in great detail. There are also many courses offered by organizations that teach the many aspects of responding to a cyber attack from the technical perspective. Although this book makes some references to material from third parties, it is not intended to be an academic book. This is because much of the material is not from academic literature or web sources, but from the experience of the author as a cybercrime investigator. The major exception to this is Chapter 12, which relies on evidence from the author's doctoral thesis on cybercrime investigation in a cloud computing environment, and where academic references from a literature review are noted. Where explanations are provided, as in the glossary, they are largely kept at a low-level technical definition, to allow those new to this field of work to understand the material and its relevance without having to learn a whole new language called technology. Due to the dynamic nature of evidence, advances in technology, and the evolution of legislation or court decisions, this book is not intended to be an exclusive guide in every legal jurisdiction or to cover every potential cyber event. Where material in this book conflicts in any way with the laws of your jurisdiction, the legal environment you operate in will always take precedence. This book intends, however, to provoke critical thinking among management, IR team managers, and investigators facing a complex legal and technical environment should a suspect be identified and subsequent evidence need to be presented to a tribunal or court. This book contains many of the steps a cybercrime investigator will undertake, from the initial identification of a cyber event through to considering a prosecution in court. There are many lists of things the investigator may consider. These are not exhaustive lists and are provided to expand the thinking as to what to do, where evidence may reside, and how to legally obtain and manage it. Use this book as a prompt and not as a definitive step-by-step template, as each cyber investigation is different and each jurisdiction has its own legal requirements. The lists in this book provide a handy point of direction in each stage of the investigation. As you will discover, at each stage there are many things to be done, and no one can remember them all every time. So, the lists are provided as a memory prompt of things to consider and apply as the circumstances, legislation in your jurisdiction, and your experience dictate. Not all items in the lists will be relevant in all instances. The explanations are in plain language, and technical terms are kept to a minimum to assist your understanding of new concepts. In Chapter 2, we provide an introduction to the cybercriminal, and a series of offenses an investigator may be called upon to investigate. These will vary according to the laws of the jurisdiction you are operating in, and terms for the offenses will vary. By gaining an understanding of the cybercriminal and their chosen cybercrimes, we gain an understanding of how the crime was committed and why it was committed in the manner it was, as well as gaining some understanding of the type of identity we are seeking. Once we understand typical offenses, in Chapter 3, we look at the motivations of the attacker. In some instances, understanding the attacker's motives will provide a strong pointer as to who the offender is, especially in cases of internal offenses. Motivations will vary across the many forms of cyber attack you will investigate. It is worth understanding the reasons why a criminal attacks a specific target, as this will make great sense to them, even if the motivation seems unusual to the investigator. In Chapter 4, we will look at examples of the alerts that may be the first indicators of the cyber event, as well as the offender's methodologies. These alerts and methodologies may be evidence in their own right and provide indicators as to the identity of the offender. While an alert will be generated before the investigator is brought in, the evidence from the alert will provide direction for the investigator to use as a platform for their investigation. In Chapter 5, we will learn the process of commencing a cybercrime investigation. We will discuss the many reasons why an investigation is commenced and introduce who a cyber investigator is. While the common response to a cyber event is to fix the system and prevent an attack from happening again, we will also ask whether there is a responsibility on the part of the data owner to identify the attacker and attempt to get the stolen data back before it is exploited. Once we have an understanding of offenses, offenders' motivations, initial alerts, and attack methodology, in Chapter 6, we will learn about the role of the law in your investigation. Should an attacker be identified and presented before the court, every aspect of your investigation is subject to critical examination in court by the defendant's lawyers, and your actions and their legality may be as much on trial as the activity of the defendant. Whether you are conducting a civil or criminal investigation, the complainant will provide direction to the investigation they want from you. They will have information on which to base your investigation, as well as the authority to provide the resources you require. In Chapter 7, we will cover the many aspects of your initial meeting with the complainant, including numerous questions you may find relevant to ask them at this meeting. Chapter 8 provides a general introduction to the role of the digital investigator for the cyber investigator. Although the cyber investigator will not necessarily be involved in the technical aspect of the incident response while the attack is underway, it will be of benefit to them to understand what the IR examiners are doing and the consequences of their actions involving the digital evidence. The cyber investigator will be involved in preserving evidence and in discussion with the digital investigator and IR teams as to the seizure of evidence, including placing a priority on preserving digital evidence, especially that which is most volatile. The cyber environment provides many unique challenges to the investigator, and a variety of these challenges are introduced in Chapter 9. As you are operating in a dynamic environment, the challenges you face will vary according to the circumstances of your case and the evidence you are seeking. In Chapter 10, we move into the cybercrime scene investigation and cover many of the areas of a search you need to be aware of and understand. Cybercrime investigations involve unique challenges to the investigator, and these are identified and discussed. As you are operating in a physical and digital environment, the challenges faced will differ among investigations, and the investigator will need to expand their thinking to understand their changing environment. Log files are critical to cybercrime investigations. When activated and secured, they will tell you a lot about the attacker, their methodologies, and the data they accessed. In Chapter 11, we will introduce many log types, where they can be found, and what they mean to you as an investigator. Log files are like video cameras at a crime scene. They can be effective, or like a camera, if they are turned off or output not preserved, can be totally unusable. Log record activity on a device and network may provide very valuable evidence as to what happened, how it happened, when the breach occurred, and in some cases, who was behind it. The investigator may need to work with the digital investigator to understand what the logs are saying. However, this form of technical evidence may be crucial to your investigation, to the point where you may be criticized in court if you did not follow this potential evidence trail. Chapter 12 addresses legal and technical issues involved in locating and lawfully seizing evidence from a cloud computing platform. As data is now stored on multiple computer servers in multiple legal jurisdictions, evidence identification and preservation has become a far more complex procedure than when the examiner could physically seize a device that was suspected of being breached. Chapter 12 covers many of the legal and technical issues to be considered by the investigator, with suggested pathways to advancing your investigation in the cloud. Chapter 13 provides a very brief introduction to the Internet of Things, or IoT, which includes the multitude of devices now connected online. Evidence may now be gathered from anywhere there is a device connected to the Internet, and the digital investigator may use this technology to support their investigation. Open source material is material that can be captured from online sources. There are numerous forms of open source information available online, and many cyber investigators are finding valuable information to support their investigations by conducting online searches. Chapter 14 introduces a sample of the many forms of open source information available and how this information can assist your inquiries. As cybercrime has become more professional over the past decade, the criminal community has created specialized markets where they can trade goods and services with customers. Criminal markets such as Silk Road and Alpha Bay obtained a great deal of publicity through identifying the manner in which members of the criminal community operate and the level of support provided to each other in training and other support mechanisms. In Chapter 15, we will introduce the dark web and discuss its relevance to the investigator, with a warning not to venture into the criminal markets unless you as an investigator are well-trained and understand the environment in which you'll be operating. In some jurisdictions, it is an offense to access the dark web. Interviewing witnesses and suspects is an art that many police officers and investigators take years to master. It is not a simple process, as each interview is unique and may be evidence in its own right. Chapter 16 will discuss many of the considerations to be undertaken when conducting an interview and safeguards that may be applied depending on the jurisdiction you are operating within. Chapter 17 discusses how to review evidence collected and provide direction as to how to proceed. Sometimes you will have strong leads to the suspect. Sometimes you may have enough evidence to commence or refer an investigation. And sometimes you will be facing a dead end with a recommendation to complete your investigation. Should you have enough evidence to refer to a tribunal, civil court, or police, Chapter 18 discusses ideas for how to prepare your evidence for court. Each jurisdiction has its own rules, and your priority will be to obtain experienced legal advice to ensure the requirements of the law and court are met. How you present your evidence is sometimes as valuable as the strength of your prosecution. Finally, in Chapter 19, we provide a summary of the contents of the book. As a prime reason cybersecurity exists is the cybercriminal, we commence this book with an examination of the potential criminal offenses that may be committed in a digital and cyber environment. Chapter 2. Cybercrime offenses. The potential offenses a criminal may commit against an entity or individual is limited only by the imagination of the attacker. The cybercriminal may be a long-term trusted employee within the organization or a person located on the other side of the world. They could also be a contractor who takes advantage of operating within the corporate network to install malicious software or access information by installing a server on the network to intercept and record all traffic without the authority of the system's administrator. This chapter seeks to present to the investigator an understanding of the many forms of cybercrime they may be required to investigate. While the investigation techniques presented in this book may be similar across each crime type, an understanding of the crime goes a long way toward understanding the criminal. This then provides direction as to where to locate digital evidence within the physical and digital crime scene, as well as to understanding the criminal's motivation. As technology evolves, so do the opportunities for the criminal community to evolve with it. As new technological products are released into the marketplace, criminals view the product or service with a view as to how it may be exploited to progress their criminal ventures. For example, when gaming consoles provided an internal hard drive to store the games, as well as to provide internet connectivity, criminals started storing evidence of their crimes, such as child exploitation material or CEM, within the hard drive of the console. So, should police conduct a search warrant at their address, they were less likely to seize a gaming console than a laptop or desktop computer. As criminals develop these skills, law enforcement reacts to them and develops their evolving field of investigative knowledge. Cybercriminals share their knowledge on open source and closed criminal forums, resulting in a higher standard of criminal who can seek experienced assistance when their attempted crime meets a hurdle. Cybercriminals also provide tutorials for those new to the industry, including step-by-step methodologies on how to commit cybercrime without leaving behind digital evidence leading to their identity. Should it be required, some sites provide one-on-one tutorials and peer review. In essence, cybercrime is a profession, with many resources available to the criminals. These same resources can also be useful to the investigator in understanding developing methodologies and the ways criminals conduct their activities. An advantage of cybercrime to a criminal, when compared to other forms of crime, is the lack of structural complexity. When compared to a crime such as illegal drug trafficking, cybercrime lacks the structural managerial complexities that are prevalent in crimes involving physical property. A drug trafficker may be required to structure the business, distribution, processing, transporting, competition, physical threats, sales network, and money laundering. In cybercrime, there are fewer of these considerations involved. As opposed to the illegal drug trade, where parties involved may be personally known to each other and build relationships, those involved in partnerships in cybercrime may not ever physically meet each other, assisting each other based on their areas of expertise. Also a valuable consideration is there are no turf wars involved in cybercrime, as there are in the illegal drugs trade. There are many other reasons why cybercrime is attractive to the criminal. One of these is the financial reward available compared to other forms of crime. Joseph Schaefer and his colleagues found that on average, the bank robber may obtain $2,500, the bank fraudster $25,000, and the cybercriminal $250,000. They also found that the cost of the theft of technology to an organization is approximately $1.9 million. Alongside the financial rewards, a further attraction of cybercrime to the criminal is that the actions required are easy to carry out and hard to detect. The internet provides anonymity for skilled cybercriminals, who use available technological resources, such as free web-based email accounts. Schaefer and his colleagues found that the anonymity cybercriminals are operating under online reduces their personal inhibitions, especially since the potential for being identified and held accountable for their actions is low. Of further benefit to the cybercriminal is that the proceeds of their crime, data, can be virtualized and geographically distributed, creating technical and jurisdictional challenges for law enforcement and other investigating agencies. Digital forensic investigations to obtain evidence may not be able to be obtained in a timely manner, meaning valuable evidence may not be available to investigators. An additional benefit to the cybercriminal is that their crimes can be committed anywhere. Data can be disseminated very quickly, and the cross-jurisdictional manner of the crime results in the need for collaboration between police services at the national and international level. To add a further layer of complexity for an investigating agency, cybercriminals may operate in failed or failing states that provide a safe haven. The specific civil or criminal offense in each instance depends upon the legal jurisdiction and the wording of the specifics of the offense as defined in legislation. While there are many forms of civil and criminal offenses involving technology, this chapter lists examples of offenses where technology is a major factor in the crime the cyber investigator is required to respond to. Also understand that when you are dealing with a cyber event and the suspect lives in a foreign legal jurisdiction, even though their action may be a very serious criminal or civil offense in your jurisdiction, the act may not be an offense in their country. In effect, in their jurisdiction, they are doing nothing wrong. As an investigator, be aware that there may be more than one offense occurring at the same time. While you are responding to a certain form of cybercrime, this may be merely a distraction to divert the attention of the incident response, or IR, security team, as the attacker's main goal may be elsewhere on the network. For example, there may be an attack against the company web server, and while the IR team is focused on mitigating this attack, the criminal can be stealing data from the email server or corporate database. The remainder of this chapter provides examples of different forms of cybercriminal offending, followed by a brief explanation. These are not listed as specific offenses, as each jurisdiction will have different wording for these activities, and there may be multiple offenses you can identify from a single description. Potential cybercrime offenses. Each of the following sections will provide some consideration the investigator may think about to support their investigation. There will be replication across the offenses. However, the comments are presented to provide a few thoughts to advance your investigation. Industrial espionage. This offense is also sometimes called corporate espionage. This is a standard form of cybercrime, with the criminal breaking through the defenses of a company to locate the intellectual property, or IP, for sale or their own use. A competitor may itself conduct the attack, or the attack may be random, with the criminal breaking in to see what they can find and exploit. This offense has well predated the internet, with insiders being used to steal IP or documents being stolen from trash bins after being discarded. As companies develop new products, competitors may find a strategic advantage in knowing where their competition is planning on being in 12 months. The theft of strategy and development plans allows the attacker to develop their countermeasures, saving years of development and expense in new product design. Specific IP may be submitted for patent by the developer, ensuring a level of industry protection against it being copied by competitors. However, should the IP be stolen prior to the patent being issued and then submitted for patent by the thief, complicated and expensive court cases, or even overall loss of the developed IP may result. Along with corporate IP, tender documents, which are due to be submitted in the following days, are a valuable target. With this information, the business competitor who initiated or contracted a hacker to undertake the attack on their behalf may update their documents to increase their chances of winning the tender against the victim company. Investigator considerations. Industrial or economic espionage is a very serious criminal offense, as the future of the victim company may be at stake. Companies put very serious money into the development of IP, and having it stolen by competitors or put up for sale to the highest bidder will cause very serious stress to the complainants. In the instance of public companies, disclosure of IP being stolen may have a negative effect on their share value. As the investigator at the scene, always respect and understand the stress of the company executives and owners. Identify who may benefit from the theft of the IP, such as competitors or new companies seeking to establish themselves. It may be of benefit to contract with a company that specializes in operating in the criminal markets to identify whether it comes up for sale. Do not discount the potential for an internal employee to be the party taking the IP and seeking to establish them in a rival business in the near future. If the IP is of significant financial value and not patented, recommend to the complainant that they still go through with this process, as they will have the product development history to support their claim as to ownership of the IP. An investigation such as this may need to be conducted into the future in a monitoring phase, as the complainant monitors who in the industry develops a product very similar to their IP or seeks to patent it. This now provides you with a reverse starting point with a suspect. By this time, you will have conducted your initial investigations. When a suspect has been identified, you may resurrect your investigation with a suspect in mind. This is equally applicable if the suspect was involved in the initial theft of the IP or purchased it through the criminal markets. Theft of information such as identities, staff files, and accounts. Similar to industrial espionage, this may be a specifically targeted or random attack. The identities may be sold online held for later exploitation, or sold back to the company as a ransom. These attacks may be internal or external to the network. Examples of personally identifiable information, or PII, stolen include names, addresses, social security numbers, passwords, phone numbers, email accounts, credit card numbers, next of kin details, mother's maiden name, and so on. The value of this information to the attacker is that it may be useful in creating databases on persons of specific interest within the organization. Other data can then be located through open-source investigation, such as social media, to develop a more detailed profile of the individual. The profile may be used to commit identity theft against the organization or a financial institution, or sold on the criminal markets as a product. Investigator considerations. Although this is a very common crime, with hundreds of millions of identities and credit card details stolen every year, the consequences to victims are not lessened. There is a saying in the law that you take your victims as you find them. And while one victim of identity or credit card fraud may take the news and move on without concern, another may suffer severe financial and emotional stress. As a very general, although not exclusive rule, stolen identities are sold on the criminal markets. Investigating in this environment is the task of a very skilled and experienced investigator. And if you do not have these skills, seek them elsewhere, as these cybercriminals employ counter-surveillance, which you need to avoid. The evidence you will locate may come from the initial investigation of the digital evidence. Did the cybercriminal proceed straight to this evidence, or did they navigate their pathway through the network before locating this evidence? Look at the business of the victim company and whether it is a company whose collection of such information is a byproduct of its core business or actually the core business itself, such as being a payment gateway. This information will assist in understanding the attacker's motivations and the type of cybercriminal you are seeking. Chapter 15 will provide more information as to conducting investigations in this environment and evidence you may locate through criminal vendors. Computer hacking to gain access to system resources. Corporations and educational and governmental organizations have access to large and powerful computer systems with processors and bandwidth. An attacker may break into a system to host a criminal site, such as a fraudulent online pharmacy, or to use the bandwidth to launch a denial of service or DOS attack against another target. Alternatively, they may seek to use these resources to mine Bitcoin. This form of attack may be lost in the traffic of normal day-to-day activity, where there is a high volume of activity on internal and external networks. However, use of the bandwidth resources confers a cost to the victim company. Investigator considerations. This is a unique form of investigation, as many victims of this form of cybercrime do not make complaints due to the potential for reputational damage. If you are entrusted to investigate these crimes, look toward who is the beneficiary of the offense, such as the online pharmacy or the Bitcoin miner. Details of the compromise may also be of interest, as the obvious offense may be the byproduct of an initial hack seeking IP and student or staff details. Academic institutes are a haven for valuable IP, being developed by postgraduate and doctoral students, which is highly prized by nation states, especially in fields such as robotics, artificial intelligence, and nanotechnology. Look very closely at what else the cybercriminal was doing, especially before the takeover of the infrastructure, and do not focus exclusively on the most obvious offending you have been tasked to investigate. Gaining or exceeding authorized access levels to obtain highly restricted data. Users of a network may seek to increase their level of access to highly confidential data. Alternatively, a hacker may gain a user's credentials within the organization and work on escalating their access to the confidential data through compromising accounts associated to the user. For example, A hacker may gain access to the personnel clerk's internal account, then use this to gain access to their supervisor's account, then use this to gain access to the personnel manager's account, and so on. This is a major concern for all organizations and government agencies and their contractors who have been compromised in this manner. Investigator considerations. Escalating privileges involves navigating a pathway through a series of users' accounts, from low to higher levels, to find where users gain access to confidential data. You may have to work backwards, from the point of identification of the breach, to find whose account was compromised in the first instance and how this was achieved. This will provide evidence of the attacker entering the organization and gaining the lowest levels of privilege. You may, for example, find a link between the attacker's internet protocol address found at the initial compromise of the junior personnel clerk's account and the internet protocol address the stolen data was forwarded to. Understanding pre-offense behaviors, including reconnaissance, testing of vulnerabilities, and phishing attacks, may provide details about offender behavior and attribution. Exploiting information security weaknesses through the supply chain, including third-party contractors. Third-party contractors often fail to provide the level of security their client is capable of providing. For example, independent contractors in Hollywood may have been the ones hacked when movies are taken and held for extortion prior to release to the public. The criminals may have determined it is easier to hack into the computer of a contractor rather than a major Hollywood studio, which has more resources to defend itself. Investigator considerations. Look closely at what was taken and who may benefit from the attack. In the example given of a Hollywood contractor, look to see whether the offender went directly to the IP or whether the IP was only located as a byproduct of examining the system. While we may think cybercriminals are very structured, motivated, and skilled types of people, sometimes they are lucky and stumble across very valuable IP without initially understanding the target they are hacking. In effect, they got lucky. Stealing credit card data for selling online, or card-not-present fraud. These attacks deliberately target credit card information for exploitation or for selling online through the criminal trading markets. This information includes names, addresses, credit card numbers, dates of birth, next of kin, phone numbers, and so on. The card numbers are used to purchase goods from online retailers using internet services, with the cybercriminal having the goods delivered to a predetermined address. This may be an unknowing colleague's address, work address, rental property, or a pickup point that specializes in receiving parcels for clients, as some postal services operate. This is known to retailers as card-not-present fraud and carries a significant financial cost for the retailer as the credit card company reverses the charge to the retailer. As an alternative, a cybercriminal may sell information from the cards to clients as a bulk item, charging per unit or at a volume discount. Should the information be from cards of particular value, such as an American Express Platinum card, it may be sold individually at a negotiated price. Investigator considerations. These tend to be large volume crimes, with hundreds of millions of credit cards available for sale online in the criminal markets. As mentioned previously, do not even consider going onto the criminal markets unless you are very skilled in online tradecraft, or even better, have brought in a cyber investigator who is experienced in this field. Identifying who is the beneficiary of the transaction is a more productive pathway for the investigator investigating individual card-not-present frauds. Gaining access to a system or device through malicious software. These attacks seek to gain access to a computer system through the delivery of malicious software. This may be either an internal or external attack. An example, is an advanced persistent threat, or APT, where a person gains unlawful access to a computer device and maintains their hidden presence, gathering new data each day. An APT may be present from a week up to several years before being found. Investigator techniques. Identifying the malicious software used in the crime is one of the first steps for the investigator. Contact the organization's security vendor, which may have resources available to immediately identify the malicious software and its characteristics. Many of these companies have very knowledgeable investigators who can provide you with information about the person and/or syndicates behind the attack. You may use this valuable information to leverage off their technical inquiries. This will be a portion of your investigation and supplement the investigation into the crime committed via usage of the malicious software. Damaging the reputation of a competitor to gain a market advantage. As competition is tough in the marketplace, damaging the reputation of a competitor may provide the attacker an advantage. An example would be a tender submitter launching an online attack on a competitor just before a tender committee sits to decide who will win the latest tender, raising serious questions about the victim's cybersecurity. Investigator considerations. In the early days of the investigation, look to see who is the beneficiary of the reputational damage of your client. While this may be a random attacker with an extortion motive, if the company is in the process of delicate negotiations with a potential client or tendering for a new contract, there may be clear signals as to who the potential suspect may be. Your client may be able to point you in this direction. Changes to computer systems or devices. This is a particularly difficult crime for a company to manage, as the attack will be targeted at modifying the data of the company. As the victim company makes subsequent strategic decisions, they will be made with incorrect data, meaning tender documents may be uncompetitive or overly cheap. Investigation considerations. This is a very personal attack, where there is no obvious suspect. Damaging data to induce the company into making poor business decisions is not of any great benefit to the average cybercriminal who is seeking a personal financial return. Speaking to the complainant will provide direction as to potential beneficiaries of the crime. Also, understanding how the action was identified will provide further direction of assistance. A person motivated to commit such an attack would include a disgruntled former employee who modifies the data before they leave as retribution for a perceived grievance. Never underestimate the motivation of an angry ex-employee. Vandalism to prove the skills of the attacker. Hackers like to prove their skills and build their portfolio of companies that they have successfully attacked. A company may be the random victim of a hacker who is seeking to build their credibility in the hacking community. Investigator considerations. As the victimology of this crime may be put down to pure bad luck, there may be a few leads for the investigator to consider from the perspective of motivation. Investigators who know their way around the bulletin boards and websites cybercriminals communicate on may pick up some details on who was behind the attack. New cybercriminals testing their skills like to let everyone know about their successful attacks for the purpose of building their reputation. Use these criminals' vulnerability related to the need to promote themselves to see what you can find out about them and to build profiles on them. Drive-by downloads of malicious software. An effective form of cyber attack is the taking control of the website of a legitimate company, installing malicious software, and waiting for visitors to the site to unknowingly download the malicious software. As it is a reputable site, the visitors will not view the site as high risk, raising the prospects of more success for the attacker. Investigator considerations. Investigating this form of cybercrime involves gaining an understanding of the technical vulnerabilities of the site exploited. Look to see where the repository of the data has been sent, which is usually a website controlled by the attacker. As noted previously, discussions with cybersecurity companies, such as Sophos and Symantec, may provide you with information as to the technical components of the attack and the leads you may generate from them. Interfering with access to a network. Denial of service, or DOS, and distributed denial of service, or DDoS attacks, are technical attacks to overload the website and server, restricting customers and staff from accessing the internet. Ex-employees have been known to cause damage to networks before ceasing their employment by loading malicious software onto the system, installing backdoor pathways into the system to allow access once their legitimate access has been removed, or deleting valuable files. Investigator considerations. Reasons for a DOS or DDoS attack may be as simple as an extortion attempt, political motivation, as a party holds a personal grudge against the target, or business reputational damage, as previously discussed. Speaking to the complainant may provide some valuable information, especially if there has been communication with the attacker. In these cases, there may have been a demand for a ransom to be paid to a virtual currency account or a demand to modify a stated company philosophy. Ransomware. Here, the attacker encrypts the hard drives of the devices they can access and also encrypts the backups if accessible. If the victim has no offline backups, they are required to pay a ransom to the attacker to regain access to their data. This attack may also include the theft of data from the device or network before the encryption process commences. Investigator considerations. As previously discussed, there will be a form of communication from the suspect. Usually, this is in the form of an email or note left on the victim's computer. Identify the virtual currency account that payment is to be made to, and identify the volume of payments being made to it. In the case of Bitcoin, you can use Block Explorer on the blockchain site at blockchain.com/explorer to input the address where the Bitcoin payment is to be made to gain an understanding of the magnitude of the crime and whether it is a random attack or specifically targeted. Phishing attacks and money laundering. Fraudulent emails are sent to induce persons to log on to a site they are a member of, such as a bank, credit card, or financial company, by using their usernames and passwords. The link included in the email is to a site the criminal has created, which is an exact image of the legitimate site the potential victim is familiar with. Once the account owner enters their username and password, the cybercriminal has access to the client's account. The difficulty for the cybercriminal is if the victim has two-factor authentication on their account. Then they will have to develop a further strategy to defeat this level of security. The next stage for the cybercriminal, once they have direct access to the account, is to remove the funds. This may present a further logistical hurdle if they are in a different country from their victim, and they cannot directly transfer the proceeds of their crime overseas. The experienced cybercriminal may monitor the account for several weeks to get a full understanding of how money flows through the account. Examples of activities of interest include when the victim's pay goes into their account and when mortgages and utilities are paid, effectively mapping the flow of money to identify when in a pay cycle there is the most money in the account. Some financial institutions have daily limits on transfers of money from an account. To maximize the financial return, cybercriminals will transfer the balance of the daily available funds at 2359 hours and then the new daily balance at 0001 hours the following day. When the funds have been accessed and the money is to be moved across international borders, the cybercriminal will need another victim or unknowing associate to assist in moving the funds to a jurisdiction they can access. The unknowing associate becomes, in effect, a money mule. The money mule is an unknowing person who believes they are involved in a legitimate business venture, or who has been socially engineered to believe they are in a relationship with a legitimate person. These shall be viewed separately, as these are common methods of removing money across international jurisdictions. The investigator may be required to interview them to identify their level of culpability. Business money mule. The business money mule is a person who has responded to an online advertisement for what they believe is a legitimate job. The most common job they are recruited for is to receive money into their bank account on behalf of the company employing them while it sets itself up in the host country. As money is placed into their account, they are required to immediately send it to a specific account or to a person using money transfer services, exchange it into virtual currency, or use their personal bank account to transfer the money overseas. They are permitted to keep a specified amount as a commission, which reinforces their belief they are involved in a legitimate business venture. This is a risky time for the cybercriminal, as they are trusting a third party to be an integral party for their cybercrime. To mitigate the risk, they may immediately contact their money mule by phone and keep them on the phone while the money is obtained and transferred. This may require an investment of several hours of their time, but helps to mitigate the risk of the money mule deciding to keep an apparent financial windfall for themselves. Socially engineered money mule. This is a very different type of person from the business money mule, as they believe they are in an established relationship with another person. This relationship may be several years long. The most common form of person to fit this category is a person who has been victimized through online relationship fraud, where they have sent money to their new friend to support them and bring them to their home country. As the relationship develops, the victim is asked to receive money into their bank account to help facilitate a business venture their online friend needs to complete to finalize their travel to meet the victim. At this time, there is a very strong emotional tie between the victim and the cybercriminal, and the victim believes what they are being told. Investigator considerations. To an investigator who has not encountered examples of individuals meeting people on the internet, falling in love, or believing what may appear to be obvious frauds, the inclination is to suspect that these victims are involved in the fraud and need to be charged. While this may be applicable according to the laws in your jurisdiction, it is unfortunately a very common occurrence. On most occasions, these people have been socially engineered and have no understanding that they have been dealing with professional criminals. To advance your investigation, seek the cooperation of the money mule to obtain as much information as you can to identify information about the cybercriminal. Email communication, Skype addresses, recorded communication, phone numbers, contact names of those receiving money sent via money transfer services, and the history of the employment or relationship may be used to advance your investigation. Business email compromise fraud. Business email compromise fraud is where an email that represents itself to be from a senior executive of the company is received by a staff member. They are seeking money to be paid urgently to a new bank account. Alternatively, a customer asks for an established payment to be made to a new bank account. However, the email is not from the customer, but a fraudster impersonating the customer. A further alternative to this fraud is the criminal gaining access to the email account of a creditor to a company and sending a legitimate email requesting that an upcoming payment be paid to a new bank account. The victim confirms this as a request from a regular creditor and has no reason to believe the email is fraudulent. Investigator considerations. Evidence may be located from confirming the attack strategy through an examination of the email containing the request to change the bank account details. If the email is a close copy of the creditor's regular email address, it is most likely an indicator the creditor has not been compromised and that the attacker has created a domain name very similar to the creditor's. An examination of the domain records of the suspect domain will tell you when the domain was registered and possibly by whom, allowing for the reality that many of the domain registry details are false. Even this information will lead you to further inquiries, as you will be interested in identifying how the attacker knew a payment was due to the creditor and who within the victim company the email was to be sent to. If the email containing the false request to change bank account details is a true email from a known creditor, there has most likely been a security breach of the creditor business, where an attacker has accessed the corporate email account, monitored the account's receivable system, and identified when an account payable by the target company is to be paid. Examination of where the funds were paid will lead to further information. Often, the recipients are money mules, and inquiries can be continued as previously discussed. Social engineering fraud. Social engineering is the art of inducing a person to commit an act or series of acts against their interests that they would not do if they fully understood the reality of what they were being told to do. In effect, online social engineering is a series of lies told by a cybercriminal to induce a person to send them money or data, or provide access to personal devices or corporate networks. These crimes have been in existence since before the internet. However, the reach of the online environment has allowed the cybercriminal to reach potential targets in any corner of the world. In fact, it is easier and safer to defraud a person on the other side of the world than it is your neighbor. There are many strategies available to the cybercriminal. However, undertaking research on their target is used across all strategies. Social media sites are researched, as well as search engine inquiries. When required, they will research genealogy sites to provide background on their target, so when an initial approach is made to the target, the criminal has personal information which can be corroborated. The business email compromise discussed previously is a form of social engineering, and we will briefly introduce a series of other examples. Relationship fraud. This crime targets the human vulnerability of loneliness and exploits the hope that a person may find a partner online. This is a particularly cruel form of crime, as victims state they find it hard to understand which was worse, losing their money in the fraud or being defrauded emotionally. A victim may be located on a relationship site or through social media. The relationship sites are particularly valuable to the attacker, as they can identify a lot about the victim from their profile, including their background, their current status, their likes and dislikes, their hopes for the future, and the attributes they are looking for in a future partner. The fraudster will use a technique called mirroring to reflect the values and desires of their target back to them by creating a profile for that purpose, or modifying an existing fraudulent profile. For example, if the target likes taking long walks on the beach with their Labrador dog and having an evening glass of red wine before the fire, then the fraudster's profile will say exactly the same things. If a victim's profile says that they have lost a partner due to a specific disease, the fraudster will disclose a very similar life event, providing a strong emotional connection. As stated, these are particularly cruel crimes. In the initial communication, the criminal will seek as much information about the victim as possible, asking numerous questions and filling in their database of knowledge with which to exploit their target. The victim will not be used to the level of interest in them being shown, and the criminal will commence using emotional language. To the victim, the purpose of going on the relationship site, meeting a compatible match, will appear to be fulfilled. Over the coming days and weeks, they will receive numerous positive messages, including I think I love you. While it may seem very unusual to fall in love with a person you have never physically met, there are literally hundreds of thousands of normal people throughout the world who have been socially engineered by this form of crime with the psychological trigger of loneliness abused. Victims will send money to the fraudster to assist them in traveling to the victim's country, including the cost of completing business ventures, required government charges, and so on. Each payment is met with a new request for more money. The cybercriminal is very skilled at this, as they will have learned when the victim receives their pay, when accounts are due, and the like. The cruelty of this crime type is shown by the manner in which the victim is socially engineered. In a relationship where people live together, the last person you usually speak to in the evening is your partner. The first person you speak to in the morning is your partner. In relationship fraud, the cybercriminal will call last thing in the evening to tell their victim, "I love you, good night," and again first thing in the morning to make a comment along the lines of, "I have been thinking about you all night. I love you. Have a great day." These are very powerful messages. Investigator considerations. The cybercriminal is usually in a foreign jurisdiction using disposable web accounts, disposable phones, and fake identities. This is a very difficult crime to investigate, and it is very difficult to identify a real-world suspect. You'll require cooperation from law enforcement or civilian investigators in foreign jurisdictions. Your local evidence will include phone records, internet protocol addresses, and money transfer receipts, as well as copies of text communication on applications such as Skype. Inheritance fraud. With the abundance of material available about people online, learning the background of people is easy, with social media and genealogy sites providing valuable resources to the cybercriminal. An inheritance fraudster will prepare.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.